मैम यू आर ऑन म्यूट, वी आर लाइव, प्लीज गो अहेड।
गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन ऑल प्रेजेंट हेयर टुडे एंड थैंक यू फॉर ज्वाइनिंग इन फॉर टुडेज सेशन विच इज आईपीआर अवेयरनेस प्रोग्राम विद टेक्निकल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑन आइडिएशन टू लीगल प्रोटेक्शन ऑफ एन इन्वेंशन विद फादर सी रॉड्रिजियस इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी नवी मुंबई महाराष्ट्र। For starting the session, I would like to invite our HOD, head of IPR Council, for inaugural welcome address, Mr. Mohammad Nahid Alam.
Thank you, Bhavna. Good morning, all of you. Thank you for giving this opportunity to host IPR awareness program. This is a part of a long campaign by Patent Office and ASSOCHAM to promote IPR ecosystem within the country. We have been doing many activities regarding IPR awareness, IPR outreach, capacity building program, technical training programs and all. And also we are doing some awards and conferences. We have a two IPFC center, one in Bangalore, one in Delhi, which is facilitating innovators from different backgrounds. I won't take too much time now. Thank you so much for giving this opportunity and look forward for future collaboration as well. Thank you so much. Bhavnaji, over to you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your kind words. Now I would like to invite Dr. S.M. Khot, who is principal of Father C. Rodriguez Institute of Technology, Navi Mumbai, for institutional welcome address, sir. Over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. So myself, S.M. Khot, principal of Father C. Rodriguez Institute of Technology. On behalf of my institute and management, I would like to thank ASSOCHAM and Patent Office for collaborating with us for creating awareness among students and faculty members. We believe strongly in our organization, research is going to be a future, and then even research and preservation of intellectual rights is also equally important. We already have a policy in place for even applying for patents in our institutes. Whichever students and faculty does work, and then the entire support system also can be extended from our side. That is in place. I think it may take some time to me actually educating our students, community and faculty as a whole, but it will be we are going in that particular direction, and maybe we'll be need continuously our support and help creating this awareness among our students, community. And we already started ECEL, and then we have our SIBA is also our parent body. I think we can do good in due course of time. Thanks again. Once again, thank you for supporting us and then conducting this webinar for our students and staff members. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your kind words, sir. Now I would like to invite our first resource person from intellectual property in Indian Patent Office, Mr. Dharmendra Pal. First of all, I'll introduce him. He is working as a examiner of patents and designs with Indian Patent Office since April 2016. His duties involve formal and technical examination of the amended and fresh patent application related to the mechanical engineering and allied branches. He is also assisting the controller for the smooth disposable of patent application. He also as a authorized officer for International Search Authority as well as International Preliminary Examination Authority from Indian Patent Office in September 2017. He has done Bachelor in Engineering from RJIIT and Postgraduate Diploma in Intellectual Property Rights from Indira Gandhi National Open University. So far, he has examined more than 1,000 patent applications. Over to you, sir.
First of all, good morning to all of you, and thanks to Mr. Mohammad Nadewalam, sir, for organizing this event. And I also extend my thanks to SM Khur sir for coordinating this event, and obviously Bhavna ji for giving me this opportunity and like my introduction. So thank you all of you. Now this, okay, presentation PPT is option copy. PPT. ये स्क्रीन में
हाँ मैं जस्ट चेक इफ या शेयरिंग
Is my PPT visible, right?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, okay. Thank you. So let's start the presentation, which is about intellectual property, right? Okay, this is my brief introduction, and Bhavna ji has already introduced me, so I don't think so we need this slide right now. So the first question is, what is intellectual property? So before entering into the intellectual property, you should understand what the property word means. Like, we consider our house as a property. Sometimes if we acquire some commercial shops or building, we consider it as a property. Sometimes we have a car, so we consider it as a property. And sometimes if we have a jewelry, so we consider it also as a property. So basically, these are the physical property. Generally, we only stick to these properties only, but this is a one part of property. And another part of the property is intellectual property, that property that you cannot be touched. Like if you wrote a book on a technical subject or anything else, or if you write a song or if you wrote a poem, so that is your intellectual property. That means you can sell it into the market and earn the money. Similarly, if you have invented an invention, like you have invented a device or a machines that can charge the electrical vehicle in a, let's say, 5 minutes, that is not possible right now, but suppose if you have invented that kind of machines or a device, so that is your invention, and that invention can also be sold to the market and you can earn a lot of money. So basically, these kind of inventions is also considered as your intellectual property. If you have invented a drug that can cure the COVID-19 or any disease, so that drug is also patentable. That drug you have invented is also come under the intellectual property. And if you have created a brand, or that brand have some value, like you have noticed these symbols, first is for Nike, second is PhonePe. So these are the brand symbol. So these brand symbols also have some kind of value attached in it. So this is also considered as an intellectual property. So I hope you know about what is intellectual property apart from the physical property. Like if we talk about the physical property, we generally consider house, commercial shops, car and jewelry. But apart from this, if you talk about intellectual property, that means something we have created by our mind, by our brain. So that is an intellectual property. Let's talk the definition of intellectual property. So as per WIPO, intellectual property refers as a creation of human mind. That means something you have created by your brain, something you have created by your mind. Like what you have created, like if you have created an invention, so that is an intellectual property, obviously. Or you have created a literary or artistic work, that is also an intellectual property. Like if you wrote a poem, if you wrote a song, if you wrote a book, or if you play, like if you created a, some kind of music and all, so that is also an artistic work, and that is also considered as an intellectual property. You have created some unique design that is totally different from the prior disclosure designs. So that is also an intellectual property, or any symbol, means or images that is used in commerce, that is something you have created, what we call it as a brand. So that is also an intellectual property. So I hope everybody is clear about the intellectual property. Now, the next question we have is, why we need IPR? Like, why we need this protection? Why we need to protect your invention? Why we need to protect your artistic work? Like, if you wrote a book, so why we need to protect it? So we need to protect it because so that it exclude other to use your inventions or copy your work or a symbol. Like, you have wrote a book, or you have wrote a poem, or you have wrote a like a song, so others cannot use it. So for that, you have to protect it. You have to take the correct IPR of that thing so that other cannot use. And second thing is economic benefit. That definitely it is your intellectual property, so you can earn a lot of money out of it. So that is the motive actually for the production of IP. So what kind of IPR we have? So we have we have patents, we have trademarks, we have geographical indications, we have industrial design, we have copyright, we have plant variety protections, and design or semiconductor or layout design. So basically, these are the IPR, these are the intellectual properties, right, which patent office give to the inventor. So let me talk one by one. Like first we take the patent. So patent in India is governed by the Patent Act 1970. So as the definition read, patent is an exclusive right granted to an invention. The first thing is clear from the first line that the patent is always granted to an invention. Now, invention, which is a product or process, that means invention can be a product or invention can be a process. There is no issue. Patent office grant both the thing. Like for an example, for a product, we just assuming an example, like if you have invented a machine that can charge the electric vehicle in, let's say, 5 minutes. So that is your product, or that is your machines. That machine is your product. You can consider it as an invention, and you can file a patent application in patent office. For an example, if we take an example of process, like you have invented a process by which you can convert the carbon or coal into a diamond, let's say, which is not possible right now, but if you have invented, so definitely that you have invented, you can file a patent application in patent office. So the first thing is clear, the patent is always granted to an invention. An invention can be a product or a process. There's no. So the period of patent is 20 years. That means if you file a patent and patent is granted to you, so that patent is valid for 20 years. After 20 years, the patent is already dissolved. That information comes into the public domain, and then everybody can use it. For that 20 years, you have exclusive right to use it. You can exclude other to use your invention. The next thing about the patent is it's a territorial right. Let's say, what is territorial right? Territorial right is something that is related to some territory. So patent is a territorial right. That means if patent is granted by government of India, that is valid within the territory of India only. So if suppose you have invented an invention and you have find the protection under IPR, like you have patented that invention in India, so nobody in India can use your invention. But outside the India, let's say in China, he or she or anybody can use your invention, because you have not protected your right in China. You have only protected your right in India. So basically, patent is a territorial right. If you want to protection in India, so you have to file a patent application in India. If you want to protect your invention in China, in USA, in UK, so you have to file your invention in different countries. Okay, so basically patent is a territorial right. So territorial right means that it is valid within the territory of within the territory. Like if the patent is granted by the government of USA, then it is valid within the territory of USA only. So I think territory right is clear, territorial right. Next is the negative right. Patent is a negative right. Why we called it as a negative right? Because negative right means it excludes other to use your invention. Like if you have a property, let's say if you have a house, you can exclude other to use your property, use your house. You can exclude other. So excluding other is a thing which we called as a negative right. So patent is considered as a negative right because getting the patent of your invention, you can exclude other to use your invention. So basically negative right means right to stop others to use your invention. So patent is a negative right. That means you can easily stop others to use your invention. So condition of patentability. So let's say you have invented something. So how you can assume that you have something or you have invented something that is patentable or not. So in patent office worldwide, these three criteria are followed. Novelty, inventive step, and industrial application. If your invention possesses these three things, like if your invention has novelty, if your invention has inventive step, and if your invention has industrial applicability. So if your invention qualifies these three criteria, that means your patent is grantable. Your patent application can be patented. So let's understand one by one what is novelty and inventive step and industry applicability. So first we talk about novelty. Novelty means newness. That is, you have invented a thing which is new, which is not discloses in any of the prior art, which is not discloses, which is not in public domain. Like you have invented, let's say the drug for COVID-19 disease. So the drug for curing the COVID-19 disease is not right now in public domain. So if you have invented that kind of drugs, so that drug is novel. So that means the novelty. Novelty means you have invented the thing which is new. And second criteria is inventive step. Inventive step means your invention has either technical advancement or economical significance. What is technical advancement? Suppose technical advance means technical upgradation. Like we have considered an example of invention. You have created a machine. You have invented a machine that can charge the electronic vehicle in a, let's say, 5 minute. So we already have a charger for electronic vehicle, but the problem is this: the charger is capable to charging the electronic vehicle in a, let's say, 2 hour or 3 hour. So that is a difficulty, but you have invented a charger that can charge the electronic vehicle in 5 minutes. So basically this is a technical advancement. Basically you have upgraded the technology. So if your invention has technical advancement, that means your invention has inventive step, that thing. So that is the first criteria. If your invention is novel or it has technical advancement, so that means if your invention is new, so then it's considered as novelty. If your invention has technical advancement, technical upgradation, technical advancement, so then it consider as an inventive step. Suppose if the technology is not upgraded, technology is same, but anyhow you have cut down the input cost. So that is also considered as an inventive step because you have created that invention in a very small input. So economical significance is a second criteria. If you have invented an invention that have less cost input, so that is also considered as a inventive step. So these are the two criteria. If any one of the criteria is followed, that is considered as inventive step, either technical advancement or economical significance. Either in general word, we say it as a cost cutting. So any of the thing happen, we consider the invention as an inventive step. The third criteria is industrial application. Industrial application means whatever you have invented, whatever you want to patent, that should be manufactured in industry. That is not a very theoretical thing. You cannot patent for a theory. You cannot patent for an idea. That is not practical. The thing you are filing for patent application, your invention should have industrial applicability. That means your invention should be manufactured in the industries. So that is the industrial application. That's a basic, very basic thing. If you have invented something, obviously you will you want to get money out of it, so you have to manufacture it, or you have to use it. So if your invention can be manufactured if your invention may be manufactured in industry, if your invention can be used in industry, so we consider as a industrial applicability. That means that your invention has an application in industries. Your application, your patent application, your invention will get some benefit to the industry. So basically, these are the three criteria which we follow for a patent application. If you have an invention, we follow these three criteria to measure whether your patent application is grantable or not, whether your patent application we grant or not. So these are the three criteria: novelty, inventive step, and industrial applicability. So again, I repeat, novelty means newness, inventive step means either technical enhancement, upgradation, or economic significance. That means cost cutting happen. So that is an inventive step. And the third criteria is industrial application. Industrial application means your invention can be manufactured or can be used in the industry. So let's go to the new slide. Just a minute. Okay. Let me take some example of patent. So here you saw the patent. This is the iPhone model. So the first time you are very familiar with mobile unlocking by your fingerprints. So that is the patentable technology, and that is patented by the Apple. So Apple has introduced in I think earlier model, like iPhone 4, I guess, in which he has manufactured this what we call as a touchpad. So this is the patentable technology, and Apple has right over it. Yeah, this is the Michael Jackson shoes, which is also a patentable. This is patented by the Michael Jackson, in which the patent so details one of the Jackson's signature move, in which he leaned forward at a slanted angle, seemingly defying gravity. So basically, if you have seen the video, dance video of Michael Jackson, he inclined himself by the 30 degree in the dance step. So this is done basically by the arrangement, and that arrangement he invented. So he have the right, he have a patent right over this. And Bluetooth technology, we are very familiar with this, but in 1994, this technology is patented by Jeff Huston. So these are the basic example of patent, like magnetic levitation, the technology which we are using right now for fast moving train. So that is patented in 1969. Yeah, this is my favorite picture. Actually, he's a boy, belongs to Jaipur. He has invented a chess. That chess have a player capacity of 6 player. That means 6 player can play a chess at a time. So basically, he's a Hirdeshwar. He invented this kind of chess. And he is the youngest patent holder in India. So let's say if you have an invention, so what your patent application should contain? So like you have created something, you have invented something, now you want to take protection for it, now you want to get a patent for it. So before filing the patent application, what form or what the technicality or formality you should follow? So if you have an invention, so for formal, you have to take a form one, which is a general introduction about yourself, like who invented the invention, name of inventor, name of applicant, and your address, your communication address. These are the things which we required in form one. And second is form two. That is the very important form to disclose your invention. So you have to make your invention or write your invention such that it should have at least abstract, a complete specification, claims, or drawing. Your invention should be drafted or written in such that it should have at least an abstract of one page. An abstract, sufficient abstract should be drafted in such that an ordinary person can understand by the abstract that what you want to claim, what you want to disclose in the specifications. So abstract is an important part, right? Then complete specification. In complete specifications, you disclose your invention as a whole. Whatever you have invented, you disclose your invention completely in complete specification. You cover each aspect of your invention, where it can be used, what are the component of that inventions, what are the parts of that invention. You disclose everything about the invention, so that is considered as complete specification. So that is a complete specification. Now we come to the claims. So claims is the important part in your invention. Claims should be drafted in such that it include each aspect of your complete specification. Claim means what you are claiming. Like if you have invented a device, let's say for an example, you have invented a device that can charge the electrical vehicle in, let's say, 15 minutes. So you have to claim it. You have to write it in a claim that a electronic our machines or our device for that is for charging the electronic vehicle, that can charge the electronic vehicle in a 10 minutes, and that machine comprises this part, this part, this part, this part, this part. And you should also characterize your claims like this invention, my invention, yeah, my machines has this part. Because of this part, this machine is considered as an inventive. This machine considered as a technological upgradation. So in claims, basically, we have drafted the claims such that your each aspect of the claim, each aspect of your invention is inside your claim. And whatever you have, like for example, if you have invented, like I'd say, charger for electronic vehicle, so that is already disclosed in prior art, that is already disclosed in public, that is already in public domain, but you have created some kind of arrangement or some kind of like technology upgradation inside the charger so that that charger become capable of charging the electronic vehicle in 5 minutes. So that component is a basic essential part of your invention, and that part should be inside your claim. So basically in claims, you should write the point which is different from the prior art. So that is very important. Basically, the protection is given to the claims, not for as a whole inventions. Whatever you have written in the claims, that is protected inside the patent. Now, obviously, you should attach some drawings so that the reader can easily understand the complete specifications or your invention. So basically, this is the form two. Like whatever you have invented, your invention should be drafted in these four categories: abstract, complete specification, claims, and drawings. And all of these are attached with form two. So this is the second part. So your patent application should contain form one, which is a basic information about the inventor and who is going to file the invention. What is your address, communication address? So this is the basic details in form one. Form two, your inventions, which is drafted in these four heads. So this is the form two. We also required form five, in which you declare that you have invented this invention. Basically, you self declare that I have invented this invention. This kind of format is available in form five. And form 18 is optional. Basically, if you want a patent, then you have to examine it. And for examination, you have to file a form 18 for request of examination. So these are the basically four forms which you need to file in a patent office to getting the patent. Now we have already discussed what can be patent. These are the three criteria: novelty, inventive step, and industrial applicability. Now, where to file? That is an important thing. Territorial jurisdiction. So if the inventor or applicant, any of the one, belongs to Maharashtra, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Goa, Daman, Diu, and Dadar and Nagar Haveli, he can file patent application to patent office Mumbai. If the inventor, either inventor or applicant, belongs to any of the state, he can file to the patent office of Chennai. If the inventor or applicant belongs to northern states, he can file the patent to the patent office Delhi. And rest of India is Calcutta. So this is the basic thing. If you have some student raised a query in earlier seminar, there is an applicant, there is two inventor, one belongs to Maharashtra and second belongs to Delhi. So whether we file, the jurisdiction of this application. So patent office is very flexible in that. Any of the jurisdiction you can follow, first inventor belong to Maharashtra, so that you can go to the patent office in Mumbai, or you can also go to the patent office Delhi, because your second inventor belongs to Delhi or Haryana. So any of the jurisdiction can be followed. This is the where to follow. Now, these are the two terms which generally used in patent application. First is priority date. What is priority date? Priority date is considered as the first date on which you have disclosed your invention. So that is the first date. Suppose you have invented something and your friend have all know all the thing. So the thing is that who is going to file the patent application first will get the patent. Like I also invented the same thing. My friend, suppose Ram is also invented the same thing. But before filing my invention, Ram already filed the invention in patent office. So patent office considered Ram as the authentic inventor of that invention. So priority date is the date on which you first disclose the invention. Like if I disclose my invention today, so the 8th of December will be the priority date for my application. If anyone file this invention on 9th of December or 10th of December, he will not be able to get the patent because I have filed this invention before anyone. So this is the priority date. That means you have disclosed the invention on that particular date. So what is provisional application? Suppose you are working on an invention and you have not completed your inventions, like you are getting ideas like we can improve this invention by this, but you have sufficiently like invented something that this is new and we can attach this part also. So if you come across that you have invented something, so you can file a provisional application. What is provisional application means? Provisional applications mean you have partially disclosed your inventions, that I have invented this, but I am also working on it to make it efficiency greater and greater. So this is the thing. So like we have seen this slide, where form one, form two, here is a complete specification. If you are partially disclosing your invention, you can file the provisional specification in that. So provisional specifications, by filing the provisional specification, what you are doing, you are reserving the date, which is priority date, that for like say for 8th of December, you have partially disclosed your invention. So you reserve your date, like I have invented something or I have invented something that I have reserved the date of priority as a 8th of December. That means you have disclosed your invention on 8th of December. Remaining part will be accordingly adjusted in the provisional specification. The rest part which you are working on, that can be added in the provisional specification, and that specification become complete specification. The condition is that you have given a 1 year. Like if you are filing the provisional specification today, 8th of December, so you have given a 1 year, like 8th December 2022. So up to 8th December 2002, you can file a complete specification. Whatever you want to add your invention, you can add it by filing the complete specification within a year of provisional specification, within a year of filing of provisional specification. So this is priority date and provisional specification. Okay, now in Patent Act 1970, there is a three sections, section 3, section 4, and section 35. These are the sections which define that which invention cannot be patented. So you should be very clear that your invention should not fall under these category. Okay, your invention should not fall under section 3, section 4, or 35. If your invention fall under these section, you cannot get the patent. Like, what is in section 3? In section 3, the first thing is frivolous or obvious. You have created a very obvious invention. Like you come to the patent office and say, I have invented a bicycle that have a headlight of bike. So that is very obvious. You can take the headlight of bike and put into the bicycle. What is invention in that? So everything which is very obvious, very frivolous, that cannot be patented. Second is contrary to the well-established law. If whatever you want to patent, that is against the well-established law, that cannot be patented. Like if you have learned the PMM1, PMM2 in thermodynamics or basic mechanics. So PMM1 and PMM2, that cannot be patented. suppose you have invented something that is against the natural law, that is against the, let's say, for the law of conservation of energy. So that cannot be patented because that is not possible. If something is against the natural law, that is not practically possible. And third is injurious to public health. If you have invented something that is injurious to public health, that can also not be patented. And next is mere rearrangement. If you arrange the something and ask that this is my invention, that is also not patentable. Discovery of scientific principle, that is also not a principle. Discovery is something which is existed earlier. You have not put anything on it. So basically, the theoretical or a principle cannot be patented. The discovery, principles, theorems, that cannot be patentable. Patentable discovery of living things, it is also not an invention, that is also not a patentable. Method of agriculture or horticulture, that is also under the section 3, and that is also not patentable. Any process for medical, suppose you have invented a process of treating the heart in a different way, that is also not a person, that is also not a, also not an invention, that is also not considered as an invention, and that is also not a patentable. Or a mathematical or a business method, that is also not a also not considered as an invention and not patentable in patent office. And section 4 talk about the atomic energy. If your invention is related to atomic energy, so for that patent office refer your application to the concerned authority, like say BARC, Bhabha Atomic Research Center, and they assure patent office that it's related to atomic energy or not. If your invention related to atomic energy, that cannot be patented. So you will not get the patent for your invention if your invention related to atomic energy or defense of India. If your invention is related to defense of India, like you have invented a, let's say, a bomb of different kind, that is also not considered as an invention and not patentable in patent office. So this is the flow chart where your patent application go. Like first you file the invention, it get published, and then examining, and then disposal, whether you get the patent or not get the patent. So these are the basic four steps. Remaining is the other thing which we discuss in the other slide, like filing, then publication. After filing your invention, your application will get published in a journal of Government of India within a 18 month, and then it is examined. If you have filed a form 18, like if you have filed the fees for examining your application, then your patent is patent application will get examined, and after that patent application, patent office will generate a report on it, whether is patent application is grantable or not, or what is the thing that you should have cleared for getting your patent. So what is the common mistakes by the inventor in inventors? So these are the three common mistakes which we found in my 6 year experience. Like generally inventor, what they do, they publish their invention in any journal. So basically, before, if you have created your invention, you have invented your invention, you have to first file the patent application. If you publish your invention, then this invention goes in the public domain. Then it's very difficult. Some others can also file the invention, then it's very difficult to find that who originally invented this invention. So before publishing it into the journal or before putting your invention into the public domain, you should at least file a patent application. Second is, you have already used, already shown your invention, whatever you have invented, and you have put it into the, like in front of media, in front of press. So that is that coming to the public domain. So before doing that, you should file the patent. Actually, before like putting your invention into the public domain, you should file your patent application. And third thing that generally inventor do very wrong, that it wait for the wait for filing. Like they say, first we completely develop the invention, then only we file. So don't do that. Whenever you come across that you have invented something that is not existed earlier, that is not in a public domain, so firstly you should file the patent application with provisional application. You can what we say, you can partially disclose your invention and reserve the date. Actually, the date is very important. The priority date is very important. If the further legality happens, then the data priority is very important. So first reserve that actually. So you come across the invention, first file the patent application by partially disclosing your invention. So these are the three mistakes. Don't do that. If you have invented something, please don't do these mistakes before publishing, before putting your invention into the public domain. You firstly should patent application. Now, what are the types of patents? So we are talking about right now, these are the ordinary application, the application filed by the Indians, or the applicant is Indians and filed firstly in the patent office in India. So these are the ordinary applications. Next, it's conventional application. Like I already mentioned, the patent is a territorial right. That means the patent you have acquired in India is not valid in China. So you have to reserve your right in China too. So conventional application give you a 12 month to enter into the any of the country. Like you have filed a patent application in India. Now you want to go for China for filing the patent application. So you can go within the 12 month of the filing of the patent application in India. So before filing into the China, you have to ask the certified copy from Indian Patent Office. Indian Patent Office will give you a certified copy of your filing. You can take this document and file your patent application in China, in Japan, in Korea, in any of the member countries of the convention application. So you can get the patent in that different country also. Third application is PCT application. What is PCT application? PCT application is something that acquires the patent in a different country that give the time of 30 months or a 31 month. So we have a time of 30 months to get your patent application filed in different countries. So we will talk about PCT application later. Divisional application, suppose you have invented something, you have filed a patent application of something. Now you are thinking that you want to add on something in your invention. So you have to file a divisional application. Like you say that you have invented something, you have filed the patent application. Now you are planning that should be the addition, that part should be added in your invention, or that part is also an invention, but that is corresponding to the previous invention. So you can file the patent of addition. So patent of addition or divisional application is this: if you have already filed your invention and you want to convert your invention into two invention. For an example, if you have invented a bicycle of a different kind, like you have invented something in bicycle when you have filed a patent application in India. Now you are saying that I have a modification in the handle of the bicycle so that it's very smooth, and you have invented something in the gear of the chain. So you are saying in my application there is two invention, one in handle and second in gear. So you can find the divisional application. You can what we call it, bifurcate your invention. You can convert your application into the two applications. This is the divisional application. And patent of addition is something you add your invention, like you have filed a patent application for bicycle. Now you want to add something on the seat of the bicycle. You have invented something on a seat of the bicycle and you want to also get the patent for that. So you can also file the application which is claiming the seat of bicycle that is attached to the previous or your mother applications. So this is patent of addition. Now PCT application. PCT application assist applicant in seeking patent protection internationally. Like if you want to patent protection in different countries, so firstly what you will do, you will file a patent in India or a receiving office of WIPO. India, Indian Patent Office also work as a receiving office of WIPO. You can file the patent application in India. Then you have to pay the fees for ISA authority for examining your application. And that will examine your application and prepare search report. And after that, you can enter into the member countries within the 30 months from the date of your priority. This is about the PCT application. There is the two things which I highlighted in a recent guidelines published by the Gazette of India on 21st September 2021. That means 2 months ago. Patent office or a government of India has reducted the fees by 80% for the university or academic institution. For an example, earlier if you file a patent application that have less than 30 pages or 10 claims, you have a fees of 8,000. And if you want to examine it, if you want to patent for it, so you have to pay 20,000 extra. So you have to pay a 28,000 earlier. But now government has given a 80% reduction in that. So if you are planning to file your patent invention right now, you have to pay 1,600 as a filing fees and a 4,000 as a RQ fees. So the amount, which is 28,000 earlier, it has been reduced to 5,600. So the fee has been reduced drastically. Like, government has given an 80% fees waiver for academicians, for academic institutions or universities. So this is the very important thing I want to tell. And this is the basically a timeline. Like, whenever you reserve your date of priority or you first disclose your invention get published in within 18 months. And within 4 years or 48 months, you can file the request of examination. That means you can request that my patent should be examined and I want a patent for that. You have a timeline of 48 months for that. So now you are saying that is, it's very too late. Like, we are talking about years and years for getting the patent. But to expedite the process, we have another thing also. Like, if you want to publish your invention, you don't want to wait for 18 months. You want to publish your invention soon. So you can request in Form 9, which is for earlier publication. So if you pay 2,500, that your application will get published within a month. So that is expedited. The thing which is going to happen in 18 months, that is happening in 1 month. So your application will get published within a month if you pay extra 2,500. And obviously 50% this is after the reduction of 80% reduction. Now, expedited examination. If you want to get your patent early, like if you are very hurry that I want my patent in this year also, so what you can do, you can pay extra 8,000. Your patent application will be examined within a month, not already exceeding 2 months. Within a month, your patent will be examined. So if you are paying 2,500 and 8,000 extra, you will get your examination report within, let's say, 2 months. So this is something patent office come with. So patent office like want that those who don't want to wait long for your patent application, those who are very hurry in getting the patent, they can pay this amount and your patent application will be examined within a 2 months, let's say. So this is all about patent. Now we going to the next, that is trademark. Now what is trademark? Trademark is any sign which is distinctive. Like, we have come across this symbol, this brand symbol. This is a symbol of Pepsi. This is a KFC. This is a Burger King. So we identify the company by this brand tag. And this mark is known as trademark. So, like, Apple phone has a trademark of this. Google has a trademark of this. NASA has a trademark of this. Burger King has a trademark of this. KFC has a trademark of this. Basically, this trademark represent that brand, that company, and that cannot be used by other. Like, you have you made a let's say burger, but you cannot put the brand name, the symbol of Burger King, the symbol of KFC. You cannot use it. If you use it, you can be in trouble. So trademark is what? The mark related to the trade, the mark that is significance in commerce. So the trademark can be a sign, the trademark can be a word, letter, number, it can be a drawing, picture, emblem. Like, we have seen, this is the picture in KFC trademark. Color combination, like in Pepsi, there is a color combination, that is a patent. Shape of good. Yes, Apple, cutted apple. This is the trademark of Apple. And graphic representation of packing. Yes, this is also considered as a trademark. So there is a lot of trademark, like for Nike, this is a trademark for LG. This is a trademark for Coca-Cola. This is a trademark for McDonald's. This is a trademark for KFC. This is a trademark for L'Oreal. This is a trademark. So basically, this, what is this? These are the legally trademark. And that is not linked with the quality. That is only just Like what we said, that mark generally represent the brand, and brand maintain their quality. So indirectly in consumer minds, these brand symbol represent the quality, but actually in legal terms, that doesn't represent the quality. So these are the brand symbols. These are the brand lines, taglines, slogans. These are the trademarks. So, okay. So what is protected? Like right to use a trademark in relation of good is protected. Okay. Like for an example, here you say this is the Burger King trademark. So Burger King company has booked the trademark with this. But in this, you can register your trademark as a burger, or you can register your trademark as a king. But as a Burger King, you cannot register, because as a combination of burger and king, that is also already registered by the Burger King company. But as a burger, and burger separately and king separately is not registered as a trademark. So you can opt for registration of trademark for burger separately or for king separately. So this is the line. And second thing, state emblems. This cannot be like, you cannot apply for trademark for state emblems like Ashoka. You cannot apply for trademark for official hallmark, national flags. You cannot ask that the like Tiranga, our Tiranga, Tiranga brand, like you have invented Tiranga Agarbatti, like for say. So you cannot get the trademark for Tiranga Agarbatti, because Tiranga is a national flag, and any national flag, state emblem, that cannot be registered as a trademark. So trademark, the term or the period, the trademark is valid for 10 years. If you are registered your trademark, if you are registered your brand symbol, that is valid for 10 years. For 10 years, nobody can use your symbol. Okay. If anybody use, you can file a suit against that company. So if you book your trademark, nobody can use that symbol, because that symbol represent your brand. That symbol represent your intellectual capacity, your brand status, basically. So that is valid for 10 years. And after 10 years, you can renew it for another 10 years. And there is no limitation. After 10 years, you can renew your trademark. And after expiring, you can renew. So basically, in each 10 years, you have to renew your trademark. And that is valid endless. The protection for trademark may be endless. If you renew continuously after 10 years, you will have the protection of your trademark endlessly. So these are the two symbols which generally you have come across, like R, that is registered, TM, that is trademark. So if R is written over there, like in McDonald's, so R is something that trademark is already registered. That trademark is already registered. You cannot use it. You cannot apply for registering it. If TM is written, that means that is in filing process or in a different kind of process, but that is not registered right now. But the company is claiming, the company is filed for trademark, or company is claiming that this is its trademark. So this is the difference basically. R means already registered. TM means not registered right now, but it is in process. Like Starbucks, this is registered. Second one is also registered. Third one is also registered, but the 2011, this trademark is not registered right now. So they have put a TM. That means they are claiming that this is, we have filed this trademark in USPTO or in any, like, I don't know in which country they have filed, but they have filed in India also, but they have filed, but they have not get the trademark for it. So they have written TM over there. There is service marks also, like a trademark. If your industry belongs to service industry, then you will get a service mark in place of trademark. Like BMW has a trademark, but Urban Club, which is a service related company which provides the services, so you see you have written over there, this is the service mark for Urban Club company. Don't confuse with the registration certification mark. Certification mark are the different. They are not a trademark. Like ISE, BSI, Hallmark, ISI, these are not the trademark. These are the certification mark, and these marks related to the certification of quality. So these are not the trademark. Trademark are the trademark for a company or a industry related to service. That is called service mark. So these are the trademarks, and certification marks are not trademark. Don't consider these as a trademark. So this is about trademark. Now we further going into the industrial design. Industrial design constitute the ornament aspect of an article. Suppose you have created a bottle. In the outer surface of a bottle, you have a different kind of texture or different kind of color combination. Then you can get the design for that. That means you have created a bottle with this configuration or this shape for this pattern. So other cannot copy your creativity, basically. So for stopping others to copying your idea, that is protected in design. So whatever you have, like the in this diagram, the shape of the chair is different. And if you get the design right for this, so nobody can make this chair. Nobody can make the chair in that particular shape and size. So this is come under the design. For an example, like bottles. So if you are making the bottle in a different kind, in a different size, in a different shape and configuration, and you apply for a design, and you, if you get the design right, so nobody in that territory can use your design. Nobody can copy your bottle. Like for an example of iPhone have a design rights over their appearance. So nobody can manufacture similarly, looking similarly articles like iPhone. Nobody can manufacture it because Apple has a design right over it. Like this is a pattern ornament. If you have like manufactured some ring, some design of earrings, if you have a like jewelry design, if you have a design over jewelry, that is different from others, and you file your design application in Patent Office Kolkata and you get that right, so nobody can use your design right. So this is basically a design. It can be your sketch, it can be your 3D designs, it can be a color combination. So all of these are the aesthetic look. That means look wise, if you have created some different kind of look that is different from others, you can have the right over it, and that is protected under the design right. Suppose pharmaceutical product, like this is a pill, this is a tablet in a combination of red and yellow. If you have a red and yellow combination pill, nobody can manufacture this pill in this shape and size and this color combination. Maybe they can manufacture in green and yellow, but not in red and yellow. Consumer, these are also the industrial design. Industrial design is valid for 10 years and it can be extended further for 5 years after paying the renewal fees. So we generally summarize all the things, like you have seen this bottle. In this the cap of the bottle is invented by the William Painter, and he get the patent for this cap. Coca-Cola written over this bottle is a trademark, and the aesthetic look of this bottle is a industrial design. So basically, in one product we have a different kind of IPR. Like we have a patent for this, trademark, on industrial design. So if we are launching this particular product, we will get the first patent for a cap, second trademark because something is written over it there, and industrial design because for their aesthetic look. Like for this image, the technology using in this camera is automatic exposure control mechanism that is patented. So here the technology used in this camera is patent. And the Canon written over this is a trademark. Basically, it represents a brand. It represents a company. So Canon written over there is a trademark. And the aesthetic look of that camera is protected under design, that nobody can manufacture exactly looking same camera because Canon have a right over there as a IPR, which is a design. For let's say Apple phone, the aesthetic look is protected under design, and the touchpad, the facial recognition, and these are the patented technology by the Apple, and the Apple logo on the back of the phone, that is a trademark of Apple. So this is a, basically these are the three important IPR, like patent, design and trademark. And another two IPR is copyright. Like if you have done some literary work, like you have written a poem, you have wrote a book, you have wrote a song, so that is protected under the IPR called copyright. If you are interested in painting and you have painted something and you want that, nobody can copy it, so you will get the IPR, you will get the protection under copyright. You have a photograph, you have a drawings, you have a capture a film or a video, or you have created a some kind of music, so that all of these are protected under copyright. So if you have a right over this, nobody can copy it. Like if you have wrote a novel, diaries or poem, you will get the easily get the copyright. If you have a musical work, then also you can get the patent. You have a choreographic work, like you have a different style of dancing, then you can also apply for copyright, or that is also that is protected under copyright. And copyright is governed by the Copyright Act 1957, which is amended in the recent time. So the period of production, like you have wrote a book, so on what time you will get the patent? Nobody can copy it, nobody can make a photocopy of your book. So that is given for 60 years after the death of the author. Like suppose if you have published a book in 2012 and suppose the author is dying in 2021, then for the next calendar year, that is 2022, your 60 year will start and your copyright protection is valid to the 2082. So your copyright protection is valid for 60 year from the beginning of the calendar year of the following the year in which the author died. So basically if author die in 2021, your protection of 60 years start from 2022 and it will be remain in 2082. So for if you wrote a book, so the protection for that book is valid for 60 years from the death, from the next year of the death. And the next right is geographical indication. Geographical indication means that is geographical indication is an indication which define the good or agriculture good, natural good or manufactured good is originating or manufacturing in the territory of that country or a region or a locality. So what is this? Actually, let's say this example, the Alfonso mango. You have you know about it. Alfonso mango is originated in Konkan region. The agriculture is going on in Konkan region in Maharashtra. If this product get the GI tag from the government of India, and after getting the GI, after getting the this protection, nobody in the country can say produce this Alfonso mango in different territory and claims that this is an Alfonso mango. This is not possible right now. If the GI tag, if the Alfonso mango doesn't have GI tag, then I can produce this mango in Madhya Pradesh or in, let's say, in Delhi, and claiming that this is an Alfonso, this is an Alfonso mango. But if Alfonso mango get the GI tag, then nobody can claim except the territory of that. Like if the Konkan region get the GI tag, that means if the mango is produced, the mango is agricultured within the territory of Konkan region, then you can claim that this is the original product. If the agriculture is done outside that region, then you cannot claim it as a original Alfonso mango. So basically what happened, like we see the example of Darjeeling tea. The tea is agriculture in a different part of country and they are saying this is the Darjeeling tea. But the tea, since cultivated in southern part of India, and they are claiming that this is the Darjeeling tea, so they cannot claim it if the Darjeeling tea has a GI right. So basically what GI indication do? They basically linked the product with the originating territory. Like Alfonso mango is originated from the Konkan region, then only the mango which is originated from the Konkan region will have the tag that this is an Alfonso mango. other mango cannot be considered, or the same breed, which is agriculture in a different part, cannot be claimed as a Alfonso mango. So this is basically a GI tag. GI tag must have the reason by which this product is agriculture. Let's say another example, Darjeeling tea, or let's say Kolhapuri chappal. If you made this chappal exactly same, the looking perfectly exactly same, but you manufactured it in Mumbai, so you cannot claim it as a Kolhapuri chappal, because for Kolhapuri chappal they have a GI tag, and only manufacturer from Kolhapuri will written in the description of the chappal that this is the Kolhapuri chappal. Anybody who have make exactly same chappal in a different part of country, they cannot claim that this is a Kolhapuri chappal, or they cannot sell their product by saying that this is a Kolhapuri chappal. Although this is looking same, although this is all the features are same, but they cannot claim it, because the Kolhapuri chappal has a GI tag. That means any manufacturer belongs to the Kolhapuri or manufactured in Kolhapuri, that can written in the description of Kolhapuri chappal, or that can say that this is a Kolhapuri chappal. Others can not say that. Like for Nagpur orange, if anyone have cultivated a orange within the Nagpur, then he or he can say that this is a Nagpur orange. If the orange is cultivated outside the orange, they cannot say that this is a Nagpur orange. So basically, what geographical indication do? Geographical indication generally exclude others from the territory. They are claiming that this is belongs to that territory, but actually they it doesn't belong. So basically, geographical indication production exclude these frauds. Like Tirupati laddu, if you make the laddu and call it this is a Tirupati laddu, you cannot call it as a Tirupati laddu, because it is not produced within the territory of Tirupati. Like Samlapuri sari, if the sari is manufactured or made within the territory of Samlapuri, then it is considered as a Samlapuri. If anyone produced the same sari outside the territory, they cannot claim it as a Samlapuri sari. These are the other types, like Banarasi sari, Sangli haldi, Kolhapuri jaggery. These are some GI tag which government of India has already given. So general overview of IPR, these are the five IPR we have discussed. Like we have discussed patent, that is valid for 20 years. Every year we have to renew it. The trademark, that is valid for lifelong, but after 10 years we have to renew it. For design right, design is valid for 15 years, and for 10 years it is valid, and after 5 years we have to renew it. Copyright is valid for 60 years, not required for renewal. It is valid for 60 years after the date of author. Geographical indication, that is valid for lifelong, but you have to renew it in every 10 minutes. So basically this is a IPR. Let's okay, thank you so much from my side. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for such an elaborative session, sir. And I must thank you. You have started from the intellectual property right. What is intellectual property right? And you have elaborated everything related to patent filing, even rebate for academicians, differentiation between service mark, trademark, as well as certification marks, and towards GI designs and everything. So thank you so much, sir. And I must say all the attendees would also be benefited from your session. So there are some questions posted in the chat box. So I would like to ask you one question. So Nanaji Krishnasagar has asked a question that if we have invented something in our territory and someone claims in another territory, what will happen? Or if someone from another territory get into our territory and got used that patented invention, so what? Basically, they want to know what kind of interaction is there. Sir, you are on mute.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So suppose you have invented something and some also filed the invention in, let's say, in US PTO, US Patent Office, and you have filed the patent application in India. So the priority date will be the most important thing here. Who filed the first will get the patent. And another one behave as a copying member. Like if you have filed the patent application in India on 8th of December, and he is filing the patent in 9th of December, then you will consider as a genuine inventor. And that person who have filed in any part of the world will be considered as a duplicacy matter. Like he will not get the patent, whether he has filed in any of the patent office. All the patent offices across the world have some tie-up. They collaborate time to time and share their database for that. So for like, if you have invented something that is not in public domain, not only in India, but also in any part of the world. Like if you have invented a device, let's say for cutting the vegetables in a different way, if you have invented a device and that device is already used in USA, let's say that device is very novel or very inventive in India, but already used in USA. So you cannot get the patent because it is in public domain. No matter it is in India or in USA or in UK, if your invention is in public domain in any part of the world, you will not get the patent.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. Second question. I think it's not that much valid, but they have asked that what about the time of patent if we have 48 months time for request of examination?
Request of examination is optional. Basically, some students, what they do, they just want to publish your invention. They don't want to write over it. So what they do, they just file a patent application and sit silently. They doesn't want a patent application. They doesn't want a patent for it. So for publishing, like they publish for journal, so likewise they publish in patent office. They file the patent application, put this invention in public domain, and suddenly they find that this invention is very useful. Others, like he can sell this invention to the industry in lakhs or crores. So when he come across that this invention has economic value, they file a Form 18. That means they file right over it, I want a patent for this. Now please examine it. So for examination, we have a time frame of 4 years. Like if you file the invention right now, you have a 4 years to apply for examination. That means you have a 4 years to decide whether you want to go for a patent or you just remain silent and want to just publish your invention. So basically 48 months for request of examination. That means 48 months for proceeding your patent application for patent side.
Yes, thank you, sir. But they want to ask that, is there any grace period or extension time in the term of the patent in such cases? Like, matlab, is there any grace period for that?
No, actually, I must say the timeline is very clear and you should follow the timeline of patent office. Basically, the act doesn't give a relaxation, but if any something happens which is like beyond our control, then we have a provision of a petition in which controller decide that your case is genuine or not. But generally it doesn't happen. Actually, it is the much complex process, so you should always follow the timeline. If you want, like if you have given a 1 year, so please file the complete specification 1 day ago, before the ending the timeline. I mean to say that don't wait for just ending the timeline. Do your work within the timeline. Actually, the timeline is very important for patent office. Nobody can help you in that regard. Actually,
thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. So moving on to the session, I would like to invite our next resource person. Mr. Vijay Kumar Shivpuje is Director Petlex Business Solutions and he is IP lead of IPFC SOCHAM also. He is mentor of change with the Government of India's Niti Aayog, Atal Tinkering Labs. He is mentor for Startup India, Minister of Commerce and Industry, Government of India. He is also co-founder of Pharma Literati, which is an online education initiative, which is working actively in the area of pharmaceutical education. He is a registered patent agent with Indian Patent Office. He is having Master of Pharmacy degree with the LLB degree. He is having 16 years plus experience in pharma corporates, law firms, and within consultancies. He has conducted more than 100 IPR awareness programs at universities, colleges, bar associations, incubation centers, custom office, industry chambers, and MSMEs. Majorly, I would like to say he is the backbone for IPFC SHM also. And over to you, sir. We heartily welcome you.
Thank you so much, Bhavna. First of all, just to clear it, am I clearly audible, Bhavna?
Yes, sir, you are.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so thank you so much, Dharmendra ji, first of all, for taking out time and giving the patent office perspective, basically, especially with respect to the inventions in the engineering inventions, basically, as well as thanks on behalf of ASSOCHAM, because I'm part of ASSOCHAM, as well as thanks on behalf of FCRIT as well, because we've been connected with FCRIT as an institution, and they are so they also have an incubation setup, CBA, with whom I'm directly connected as such. So thank you so much, Dr. S.M. Khot sir and Sushil Thale sir, for allowing us to conduct this particular workshop at FCRIT for the students, basically. And before I actually move on to the session, there are some questions I can see. I would love to take these questions with the permission of Dharmendra ji. Of course, both of us would try to answer these questions, and then I'll move ahead to the session actually. So I think a question Bhavna ne pucha tha, which was, I think thoda sa context alag galat ho gaya Bhavna. What is the question from Muhammad Ansari is that, why is it that the patent issuance time, grant time is very high, or why at times 40 at once? I mean, generally we require 3 to 4 years. That's how we tell actually for getting the patent granted. Let me take this question before going to Dharmendra ji, because I think Dharmendra ji ne apne session mein he covered that we also have now expedited examination. And let me tell you my own experience. We filed an application in the month of April 2021, and hopefully by today or tomorrow we would get the grant certificate. 7-8 mahine mein bhi patent grant ho jata hai. And why I'm saying 7-8 months, because 6 months is the minimum waiting period after publication that the patent office cannot grant it. So long back we had these practices, what you mentioned, Muhammad Yunus Ansari, ki 48 months are required, but now that's not the case. If you are really, Dharmendra ne ek bahut acha term use kiya tha, you are really in hurry, aapko bahut jaldi hai, then you can get it granted very, very quickly actually. But then there is a risk as a patent agent, I would tell you, that in that quick time, expedited examination, it's a dual-edged sword. It can also get rejected. That you also remember as an educational institution. Okay. So we have a question from Aniruddha Salunke. What are your views on India's IPR index and how can India improve on it? Maybe Dharmendra, you can take this question and maybe then I can also comment. I think you are on mute.
Yeah, I will take the question in last. Please go ahead.
Okay. So an IPR index, India IPR index. So traditionally we have not been considered as an innovation economy, basically. We were more of a manufacturing economy. And just say Khot sir ne bhi apne inaugural mein bataya tha. We are now focusing more on innovation or patenting. Traditionally, हमें जो रिसर्च पेपर से रिलेटेड एक्टिविटीज हैं वो हमारी फोकस रह चुकी है. एंड आई थिंक द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज इन कनेक्शन विद दैट ओनली, अनंत कुलकर्णी, डू रिसर्च पेपर कम अंडर आईपीआर एज दे आर कॉपी राइट ऑफ द पब्लिशर्स? बेसिकली रिसर्च पेपर द कॉपी राइट of that research paper may be with the publisher, you are the author only. And yes, they do broadly come under IP, but then that monopoly is with the publisher. We also have a question from Nilesh. Can we apply for patent if we are able to bridge the gap between two technologies? I think, Nilesh, very smart question, I would say. But then you need to ensure that that bridging of the gap between two technologies can fulfill those three golden criteria of patentability, novelty, inventive step, and industrial applicability. Also, you should ensure that your invention is not falling under what Dharmendraji covered under Section 3 or Section 4. Ye criteria, agar aap satisfy kar rahe ho, then for sure, Nilesh, it can be patented. Although it's a bridging a gap. But then I think, see, theoretically and practically, there are differences basically when we especially think of inventive step or non-obvious. We have an interesting question from Megha. Can educational methods be patented? The answer to this, educational methods, so like method of teaching would broadly come under business idea. So like, you know, I'll tell you, when we think of patents specifically, two things generally are patentable. One is a product. Show me the product. What is that product? In case of educational methods, when you say teaching methods, that may not be patentable. Or process for preparing that product, that can be patented, Megha. But Megha, what can be patented in educational methods, I'll tell you. You come up with a technology basically, and again it's a hardware, let's say, for teaching or making it like, you know, more student friendly, let's say, any device or like, you know, kind of instrument which would help you in education, that Megha for sure can be patented as such. Then what is the difference between design and utility patent? So patent, I think Dharmendraji already covered this. Patent is basically for your invention, the functional aspects of that particular invention basically. And design is something which is for the aesthetic look, how the product looks basically. So Anandji, to be honest, the design patent terms come US, like, you know, in US it is called as design, is called as a design patent. In India we have patent, which you generally call as a utility patent, and we have something called as industrial design, which in US or some other jurisdiction is called as a design patent basically. Okay, so to tell you basically the difference, I would say, between a design and a like, you know, a patent basically, as I said, patent would cover the actual functioning of the product. Okay, how does it function, and based on that you get that protection. Of course, there are lots of differences in terms of its protection, in terms of the requirements, as well as in terms of its enforcement as well. Okay, but then honestly, primarily speaking, the major differences are the design would cover the aesthetic look, how it looks, nothing about the utility or its functioning basically. Patent would cover its functioning actually. Anandji also has a question on yes, Dharmendraji, please.
May I take this question actually?
Please.
Basically, if I'm not wrong, the question is, what is the difference between design patent and utility patents?
Absolutely, yes.
So utility patent is something that is not in Indian patent office. Basically, that is a concept which is used in China and Korea. Basically, you will get a lot of utility patent in Japanese, Chinese patent office and Korean patent office. So basically, what is utility patent? I will summarize in a minute. I think the question of Anand will understand what is utility. In Indian patent system, we have a IPR called patent, in which three criteria is must: novelty, inventive step, and industrial applicability. We have rejected a most of the invention because of inventive step. The invention is new, but it doesn't have a technical advancement, or it doesn't like cost cutting or economical significance. So because of that, we have rejected the invention. But in Japan patent office, in Korean patent office, or in Chinese patent office, what they generally broadly do, they generally ask that you should file your invention. And if your invention is new, and applicable in industry, you will get the utility patent. That means the criteria of inventive step is somehow missed in utility patent. So you have come across an invention that is new, but that it does not have a technical advancement or that does not have a like economical significance. In spite of that, you can get the patent, and that is called utility patent. Indian Patent Office is also working on it to get the utility patent. And they are like, there are some pro and cons that why we need to utility patent. Because after all, if it does not have a technical advancement or this, it does not have a economical significance, so at the end, aapko usse, you cannot earn the money out of it. So basically, that's why we are not right now. We don't have a utility patent option, but in South Korea, in Chinese patent office, they have an option of going to the patent or going to the utility patent. So in utility patent, they missed the criteria of inventive step. If your invention is new and industrial applicable, they will grant your utility patent. So this is what I think.
Yes, yes. And Dharmendra, just to not make the things complicated for Anand. So the utility patent, at times also called as a utility model, basically, which may be different from patent system, but patents generally in few countries are also called as so patent is generally considered as a utility patent. As a utility model is a separate concept, basically, right? As you mentioned about Korea and China, we also had this system called innovation patent in Australia, which was exactly the same, which has been, I think, in the month of August or September, that system has been now revoked, and they don't have a innovation patent, basically. Okay, thank you, Dharmendra. So we have an interesting question from Akshita. Very interesting, I would say, because I like this kind of questions. If we are filing IP through organization, for example, person X, we'll call X as Akshita. Akshita is working in Y company. Let us say Akshita is working in FCRIT, files an IPR with the help of the company. So that is with the help of FCRIT. So Akshita is working with FCRIT, and then she files the IP means with the help of FCRIT. Then is whose name is the patent or IP, the inventor or the organization? एक चीज तो अक्षता आपने एक चीज यहाँ पे बहुत अच्छा किया है कि एटलीस्ट यू हैव डिफरेंशिएटेड इन्वेंटर और एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन मे बी आई थिंक धर्मेंद्र वुड यू लाइक टू टेक दिस क्वेश्चन
आई डोंट माइंड इट बेसिकली सो एज आई मेंशंस विद योर एप्लीकेशन यू फाइल अ फॉर्म 1 इन व्हिच वी विल आस्क द जनरल इंफॉर्मेशन अबाउट योरसेल्फ सो देयर इज अ टू कॉलम फर्स्ट इज एप्लीकेंट एंड सेकंड इज इन्वेंटर So you should mention who is the applicant, basically the patent right reserved to whom. So if you mention applicant as a FCRIT, the patent will goes to FCRIT, and your name is mentioned as an inventor, and you also want the right over it. You can be also an applicant. Like for an example, we have a multiple applicant. If you have an invention, applicant, let's say X is an organization is an applicant, and Akshita also, you can also be an applicant. There is 2, 3, or 4 applicants. So if you want to write over your patent, you should be the applicant for the invention. And over the inventor, the right over the invention is always have jo Akshita ka agar inventor hai, to aapke paas as a inventor rights rahenge. But as a applicant, agar aapne apna naam inventor applicant mein dal rakha hai, तो आप उस इन्वेंशन के एप्लीकेंट होंगे अगर आपका नाम एप्लीकेंट में नहीं है एप्लीकेंट एफसीआईआईटी के नाम से ही आपने फाइल किया है तो द राइट्स बिलोंग टू एफसीआईआईटी ओवर टू यू सर
यस सो अक्षता लेट मी टेल यू एन इंटरेस्टिंग स्टोरी हियर व्हिच हैड हैपेंड विद अस व्हिच यू कैन वेरी इजीली कोरिलेट टू फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल व्हेन यू से एप्लीकेंट और द राइट्स द लीगल राइट्स वुड बी विद एफसीआईआईटी But FCRIT as an organization or institute cannot file an application without including Akshita as one of the inventors. So they cannot actually do that. Now, let me tell you that interesting story. For like couple of years back, this happened with me. One of the students approached me And she said, sir, we have to file a patent. Of course, I practice as a patent agent. We have to file a patent. I said, fine, you share the invention and send across via email, and then we'll evaluate the patentability for that, and then we can go for the patent filing. Then she called me up and she said, sir, meri ek condition hai. Mujhe na apne guide ka naam usme nahi include karna hai. That was the condition. And this is actually a live case that happened with me. I said, why so? Of course, she had her own personal reasons not to include the guide's name. But then, that point of time, I realized, so for example, a student has worked with an institution. To be honest, a patent office never asks, where have you worked for this invention? Like, you know, so whatever you provide as a declaration or as a form, form 1, 2, 3, 5 or form 26, based on that, your actually patents are evaluated. Patent office would never ask, where have you worked basically? So can a student file without the permission of an institute or a guide? Yes, that is possible as such, as long as there is no IPR policy in place at an academic institution. That's why we suggest or recommend to have IPR policy in place. In fact, MHRD, that is now what we call as a Ministry of Education. So MHRD a few years back had come up with a model IPR policy. Who can file the patent? Like, you know, or like, you know, who would own the legal rights for the patent? Or let us say that. So there are lots of things basically included in IPR policy. Most of the first year institutions, including the IITs, or in pharma, we have NIPERS, or the technical institutions like IITs and all, they do have IPR policy in place. But then those ensure, because it's just not about who is the legal owner. So for example, it may also happen, Akshata, that like, you know, I am working with a corporate or a company or an institution. I leave that organization and file the patent for that, actually. Now, does patent office have a control, or would they ask for it? Where have you worked? No. So as an institution, as an institution, if we have IPR policy in place, all these kind of complicated questions would be resolved. I think that's how we would like to answer your question. We have a couple of questions from Yogesh Chandurkar. Can any process for medicinal, surgical, curative, prophylactic, or treatment of human being? The answer to this is absolutely no. It cannot be patented. It is included, excluded rather, under Section 3. And Yogesh also has a question. Can AI-based mathematical or business method or computer program per se or algorithms be patentable? Dharmendra ji mana kar rahe hai, toh hame nahi milega ye. To be honest, we won't get this granted. This has been a bit tricky actually, when we say computer program per se. So if it's a software or an algorithm, it's difficult or it's not possible to get. But if it's in hardware, and if it satisfies those golden criteria of novelty, non-obviousness, and industrial applicability, as well as if it doesn't come under the domain of Section 3 or Section 4, then you can get it granted. Now, like, you know, correct me, Dharmendraji, if you feel like my statement is wrong.
Nani, you are absolutely correct. I just want to add something, that we have a recent meeting with CGPDTM in a recent time in 2021 only. And we have published the CRT guideline, computer related aspects guideline, in which we have clarified that which program, generally computer programs comes under the copyright protection. But now if you want to patent, so please read this CRI guidelines broadly. Some of the aspect of the computer program is included in invention, consider as an invention, and you can file a patent for it. Like for an example, you have created a device, you have invented a device. In that device, some part is connected with the computer program. Like in that invention, a small part of your invention is running by the computer program. So when you invented your invention and you are claiming your invention as a whole, then obviously you can patent. But for, if you want to patent for the computer program, so it is not patentable actually. And it is Section 3K which rejects your patent.
Yes. And this is the last question before my session. This is from Prasad Kulkarni. Seven dimension view is not available in electronics design. In some cases, design with tools, only functionality is considered during this design process. Okay, novelty is available in case of some functionality. To be honest, Prasadji, to answer, I think you need to a bit reframe the question. It's not pretty clear, but what I understand from this is part of the device is novel, and then how we can file IP. Basically, IP filing, patent filing you can do, but then the grant or the actual patentability would depend on those three golden criteria based on the entire device actually, okay, and not based on single parts. Okay, that's how I would like to comment on this. So thank you so much, Dharmendraji, once again for having that interesting discussion, especially answering these questions. Let me start with my agenda now, and let me just share my screen. All right, can you confirm, please, Bhavna? Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you so much. So what we saw in previous session is what happens when you file a patent application. What happens, how does it how does it go to the patent office, or I would say what happens once an application is filed. But beyond that, what is important is what happens at the back end before you file the patent application. What happens at the back end? What is that entire process? Of course, what we saw was patent office perspective, how the application is treated basically. Now I'll tell you agent's perspective, or maybe inventors or applicants or educational institutions perspective as far as the invention is actually concerned. I have been associated with a lot of institutions, with some incubation centers, as well as startup ecosystem, engineering institutions and all. We know the innovation life cycle. Basically, you identify some problem, you validate that problem, come up with some an idea, you do some experimentation, and finally, you want to commercialize the invention basically. Now, patents come at a point wherein you have this ideation stage basically. You know the problem, you are coming with some ideation, and I think how it was covered in the previous session was a provisional application you can file, and after experimentation within a year you can actually come up with the complete application. Remember that when we think of commercialization, the patent rights do not give you any commercialization rights. Now what does it mean by that? Patents are also negative rights. Now, if I have a patent, in that case, I still cannot commercialize the product. I need to go through the routine process of approval. So like in case of, let us say we are thinking about the 5G as a technology or 6G as a technology tomorrow, and there are any patents related to that particular technology basically, they are granted. In that case, if the patent is granted, you cannot still market the technology, or you cannot still commercialize the technology. What you require basically is approval, what we call as a regulatory approval. So if you have a technology, in that case, 5G technology or 6G technology, let's say, the patent related to that, in that case, you need to go to TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, to get the permission to commercialize it. Then only you can go to. But then, if you have a patent, no one except you, let me repeat, if you have a patent, no one except you or without your permission can actually go for commercializing that technology. If I have a patent, in that case, only I or someone who is authorized, that person can actually commercialize that particular technology with the proper regulatory approval. Let me tell you an interesting, example to just let you know how does the patent system basically work each one of us, most of us have watched this movie Three Idiots, and what we have seen in that movie is there is this one character called Punsuk Wangdu, who has got lot of patents, 400 plus patents in his name. And then he has another friend of his, a classmate, who comes down all the way from US. His name is Chatur Ramlingam. Now, Funsuk Wangdu has got some patents, okay? He doesn't want to commercialize it because he's least interested. He's an inventor. He's a scientist, basically. He's someone like you or me, basically, who are more interested in inventions or science, basically. Like, you know, now. But then there is another party who is interested in commercializing it. They cannot do because I have the monopoly rights with me. Or Funsuk Wangdu has a monopoly right. Chatur Ramlingam cannot commercialize that invention. So Chatur Ramlingam has to get a license from Funsuk Wangdu. That's when he can use or commercialize that particular invention. That is very crucial to understand, basically. So that's how the patent system basically works. And as it was covered in the previous session, like it is the first to file kind of system. What I have done here in is I have tried to collate, like just like what we had just now, the questions, like, you know, questions that were asked by the participant. I have collated some more questions which are commonly asked by academic institutions or the scientists or the professors. Let me try to have my session in a way that these questions are resolved. When should I file a patent application, actually? A patent application, the ideal time of a patent application filing is the moment you ideate it, you have a confidence. So you have an hypothesis and you have a confidence that this would definitely work. I'll have to just experiment it. Of course, your hypothesis is based on some assumptions, basically. Right, you know, that's where you can file a provisional patent application. Now, that provisional patent application, after experimentation, you have 1 year time within which you can file it as a complete. But if you file a complete application, if you have all the data ready with you, you didn't file at the time of hypothesis ideation, but you experimented, in that case, you can file the complete application directly. Now, why should I file a patent application? Of course, we are speaking in front of an academic setup, basically. I'll tell you, for the faculties, of course, we have various reasons, like, you know, for your CV. Of course, in case of commercialization, typically patent system works, as I said, pro-innovation. Patent system promotes the innovation, basically. So, to block other, if you feel like there is a commercial value for your product, and you need to block others, you need to create monopolies, then you should file a patent for that. This is a practical aspect for the corporates. Let us think of an academic institution now. From a typical academic institution point of view, patents has to be filed, especially for the faculties or researchers, for the purpose of, of course, they're building of CV. That's the right reason, I would say. And to be a bit blunt on why should an institute file a patent application, it's going to help you in your NIRF ranking. It's going to help you in your NAC and NB accreditation as well. I also have an interesting story about a student who filed a patent application. Now, this is a story from one of my clients, I would say. She was from pharma, a topper from Mumbai University, actually, during her undergrad. She was doing her master's. Now, what happened with her is, like, you know, she was aiming for some scholarship for one of the conferences in UK. And, she came to me and she said, sir, we have filed this, we had already filed her patent application, actually. And she was like pretty confident, sir, Mumbai University se hu. I'm a university topper for 4 years. I have got great credentials and I would definitely get this scholarship for the travel funding, basically, to UK from Government of India. Now, she went to Delhi for interview. She called me up from there. She said, sir, probably I won't get this scholarship. I said, why so? सर आई थॉट आई एम द ओनली यूनिवर्सिटी टॉपर, बट यहाँ पे तो एटलीस्ट आउट ऑफ 200 कैंडिडेट्स देर आर 50 कैंडिडेट्स हु आर यूनिवर्सिटी टॉपर्स अमंग देयर ओन यूनिवर्सिटीज बेसिकली, राइट? यू नो, एंड आई कांट, आई डोंट नो हाउ कैन आई डिस्टिंग्विश मायसेल्फ फ्रॉम अदर्स बेसिकली. एंड यू नो वॉट, सो आई सेड यू जस्ट गो इनसाइड, अपीयर फॉर द इंटरव्यू एंड देन लेट्स सी हाउ इट एक्चुअली वर्क्स. She went inside and she she had a couple of questions, but then the very first question was, why did you file a patent application? And this was one question she had prepared, that I want to commercialize my invention, block others from using my invention basically. Let me tell you, there was just one sub question to this and her interview was over. She was like, sir mujhe kuch pucha hi nahi unhone. It was hardly 2 minutes. There were many people who were there inside for 10-15 minutes. Let me tell you what happened at the result. There was only one position for that funding basically. And out of those 200 candidates, she was the one who got that funding. Why I'm saying you this, telling you this, is it can distinguish you from others. She was the only one of students who during her education had filed a patent actually out of 200, and she was the one. This was the one distinguishing factor which helped her. So for students, if you are coming up with your ideas, if you are coming up with your startups, ensure that you file a patent application as well. What data do I need to file the patent application? To be honest, for provisional, very less data is available, as well as less data is also required basically for filing a patent application. You need more data, examples, experimentation, characterization kind of stuff when you file a patent application as a complete. Now, shall I take help of a patent agent for filing? Patent office doesn't make it mandatory. You can file your patent application on your own. Let me tell you, patent agent is a different concept from a patent attorney or a lawyer basically. So patent agent, I'm not an advocate, I am a patent agent. So a science person or engineering or pharmacy person like me or you can appear for patent agent exam and crack the patent agent exam and practice in front of patent office. Rather, lawyers are not allowed to practice except in one or two events. Lawyers are not allowed to file the patent application at the patent office. They take help of patent agent, because there is a rationale for this actually. Because the patent is a techno-legal document. Unless I understand the technology that is developed by you, we may not be in a position to file the patent application. And like someone asked about the electronics or the computers or biotech, is difficult technology to understand even for science people. So that's the reason we have this concept called patent agent, wherein engineers, if you are in final year or if you are graduated or if you are a faculty, you can appear for the patent agent exam as such. You should take up help of patent agent, because as I said, you are a technical expert, absolutely fine. You know your invention really well. But the patent is not a technical document. It's a techno-legal document. And patent agent understand the legal part of it. That's the reason you should take a help of patent agent. Can I publish my research before? I think Dharmendraji already covered this. You cannot publish your research before patent filing. After patent filing, you can do that for sure. Can I commercialize my invention after patent filing? Yes, you can. You cannot commercialize your invention before patent filing, because the first criteria of novelty gets killed if you publish or commercialize your product. How much is the cost for patent filing basically? I think this was already covered. Now the patent office has fortunately reduced the fees for educational institutions by 80%. Okay, so the cost is really very less as far as the patent filing is concerned. Even patent filing to grant, that entire journey also, the costing has been cut down now by the patent office. Now earlier it was as per the corporates, now it's as per the individuals basically. Like, you know, can I file patent application without telling my institute or guide? I think I covered this question already. Can someone else file patent application of my invention? That's pretty interesting. India mein ye possible hai. We are working in a lab, 5-6 different teams working in a lab, sharing a computer, and then unfortunately someone else filing patent application, which is your research. That happens actually, like, you know, in many cases. But then how would you, like, for example, I am working in a lab and my colleague is also working in the lab. We both are working on different projects. I file a patent in my colleague's invention, for his invention. He would only come to know once my application is published after 18 months or whenever, basically. Now, there is a way to avoid this, or, like, you know, he can claim the rights, but then it is always essential that you should avoid it upfront. These things should not happen in your institution, basically. Now, important aspect herein is that you should have an IPR policy in place, actually, as an academic institution. And it's not related to just patents. It may also relate to copyright as well. Why I'm saying copyright? Because when we are virtual, at times, like, you know, I think we are accessing so many softwares, licenses, softwares. At times, unfortunately, it may also happen that, we are accessing some unauthorized content as well. So IP policy basically covers all these aspects to avoid it. Let me tell you what does IP do, basically, or IPR policy do. IPR policy works as an insurance for you, all your inventions or research that is happening at an academic institution level. It is very essential because the cost there that you may need to pay later may be really very high if you are not abiding by the IPR laws. And let me tell you what, unfortunately, if you are not aware of the IPR laws, that's not the justification or something which would make you escape free, basically. It's like, so if you are not aware, still it is your duty, the liability would be on you that IP infringement is a serious concern as such as an organization. Now, that's what about IP filing. When does the application get published? Aap jo patent application file karte ho, 18 mahine baad publish ho jata hai. Aap jo patent application file karte ho, 18 mahine baad automatically publish ho jata hai. Now, what is important herein is that there is an early publication as well, which was actually covered by Dharmendra ji. In few cases, we have seen Tuesday ko humne file kiya. Friday ko publish ho gaya. Every Friday the applications get published. Now we have a question here. I'll take that question from Anand Kulkarni. Can we file a patent for already published work? No, not at all, Anand ji. In fact, I have one case right in front of me. The inventors themselves published some work in 2012 and then filed a patent in 2017. Now their own work is actually creating a problem, because see, Anandji, the novelty is absolute novelty. Aap khud publish karo ya third party publish kare. Okay. If your invention is in public domain, novelty is killed, you won't get that patent. Okay? Now, how much time does it take to get the patent granted? Usually 3 to 4 years, as I said, in the normal process. In expedited nowadays, we have got 7-8 months time as well, within which the patents are getting granted. Is publication of application a sure grant? No, not at all. In case of a patent, application gets published first, uske baad uska examination hota hai, and thereafter the grant comes later. So publication doesn't give you an assurance that there is a grant of a patent. The next What is the cost after filing till grant? As I said, patent office cost is very less, and I think agents charge professionally, like, you know, as per their expertise. Can I commercialize the invention after grant? Absolutely, yes. Would I be Phunsuk Wangdo once patent gets granted? I remember this one particular case which I saw on LinkedIn, wherein one of the professors, I won't name the institute or professor, but he published on LinkedIn, I want a patent granted now, looking forward for commercializing this invention. Patent grant has nothing to do. So he wanted to be Phunsuk Wangdo, mere paas patent hai, koi to aake mere technology leke jaye. That doesn't work that way. What is important for us to understand is that it's not the patent that would be commercialized. It is the technology that gets commercialized. The technology or the invention that you have developed, if it has got value, then automatically someone would come and take the license for it. The difference herein is that patent, so this is a technology which can be commercialized, and patent just protects this technology. If you don't have a patent, the licensee won't come to you basically. He can automatically take it because you don't have a legal right. So ye aapke paas technology jo hai, uske legal rights aapke paas hai. Okay? And then technology, if it has a commercializable value, then only you would be Phunsuk Wangdo. What is the difference between a design and patent? I think already covered this question. Now let me take you through the journey of a patent. But before starting, there was a lot of discussion about research papers, and Dr. Sushil mentioned in the morning that we have got lot of faculties as well who have joined in. So let me start with the differences between research paper and a patent application, so that we are on the same page. Basically, what you do, like, you know, as a research paper writing, and as a, what I do as a patent drafting, basically. So publication, as I said, is post analysis in case of research paper. In case of patent application, there is no evaluation. Novelty hai ki nahi, inventive step hai ki nahi, is evaluated only after publication. That is more important. There is no fees for research paper, but of course there are some journals who are taking some fees as well nowadays. Patent application ke case mein, there is a fees involved. Timeline, as I said, 18 months normal in case of patent application, and 1 week to 1 month in case of early publication. A research paper ke cases mein, this is variable. Grant of a, I would say, so eventually your research paper gets published only if the invention is novel. Kuch to naya hai, tabhi wo grant, tabhi wo publish hoga. In case of patent, we also have that secondary criteria. As a research paper, you would have only rights as an author. There are no legal rights. You publish something and the technology is great. I am a businessman. I feel the technology is really good. He doesn't have a legal right. I'll use that. And let me tell you something. This happens in many cases. You have a technology. You have not filed a patent for that. You have published it as a research paper. Someone else can use that technology without giving even some kind of, I would say, reference to you, or any kind of credit to you as well. In case of patent, the legal rights are with the patentee. So no one else can commercialize except the assignee or licensee. In case of research paper, anyone can do commercialization. Types of rights in case of research paper are global. In case of patent, it is the jurisdictional right. Expertise, I remember my master's guide told me that, Vijay, if you really want to write good research papers, you need a lot of practice. Same is applicable in patent drafting. And that's the reason we tell, if you have a really good invention, take a help of a patent agent who understands your technology and can file a patent for you. In case of research paper, the significant part is the results. In case of patent application, it is the claims, what we call as a legal boundary. We have a question from Shruti here. Fee reduction is applicable to institutional application? Absolutely, yes. That's applicable for the educational institution. Now, how does a typical patent system work? Patent, you have an idea, you disclose it, you file a patent, and that gets published in public domain. Remember that everything is in public domain once you file a patent and it gets published. Thereafter, your patentability analysis starts. The novelty, non-obviousness, or what we also call as the inventive step, and industrial applicability, as or what we also call as a utility or use of the invention. Now, the journey of a patent from filing to grant at patent office, the journey of a patent application from filing to grant at a patent office is called as patent prosecution. It's a legal term basically. After the prosecution, the patent gets granted. And after the patent is granted, as I said, the term of a patent is 20 years from filing. And after 20 years, the invention is open for exploitation. Mere paas legal rights sirf 20 saal ke hai. After that, anyone, literally anyone can use your invention actually. Now I'll take you actually how we work and how does actually how we work with the academic institution, how does an application is filed and how does it get granted as well. Now, so of course I have included some live examples here. You have an invention, let us say, and then you want to file a patent. The first thing that need to be done, if you approach any patent agent, attorney, law firm, anyone for that sake, sign a non-disclosure agreement, also called as confidentiality disclosure agreement, CDA. File a CDA actually with them, then only share the thesis or the research. So we work with a lot of institutions wherein we get the entire thesis before submission, actually, of course, before submitting it to the university. We evaluate the thesis or research work and a patentability report is generated. Patentability report is an internal document that we create as a patent agent for the client, wherein we tell them, okay, your invention is patentable or not. If yes, why so? If no, why so? Once that patentability report is generated, we share that report to the client, and that point of time, the client would let us know whether to file a patent application or not. Once we do that, we file the draft it, review it, and then we file the patent application. The moment we file the patent application, you get this kind of receipt, the one which you can see, what we call as application filing receipt. It includes few things like date of application, 24th 7th 2020, patent application number, then the applicant name to Dr. Rajni Athavale and her address, as well as the title of the invention. So this is the application filing receipt. This is a proof from Government of India that you have filed a patent application. Now AFR is generated in the name of the applicant basically. Now once you have the application filing receipt, from the very same day you can use this application in each of your credentials, be it your institutional credentials, be it your CV. You would use it as a patent filed on 24th July 2020, numbered this and titled this. That's how it would work for an academic institution. As an individual as well, for your CV or rankings or accreditations, you can use this under filed category. Now, after filing, the patent application automatically gets published after 18 months. Now, look at this. Date of filing was 24th March 2017. And the publication date is exactly 18 months. That is 24th September 2018 it should have been. But the patent office publishes the journal on Friday. So it was 28th September 2018. 18 months ke baad, automatically it gets published. Now, there is an early publication process under which you would have publication in, let's say, 1 week to 1 month as well, with payment of some extra fees. Now, this is the stage wherein your application is in public domain. Now, your invention till this date, even patent officials don't have access to your invention. Till this date, even patent officials don't have access to your invention. It's basically filed and is with the IPO, Indian Patent Office. Now, thereafter comes a stage wherein you have to file. So there is no examination till date. आपने कुछ फाइल कर दिया वो ऑटोमेटिकली पब्लिश हुआ. उसके बाद यू हैव टू फाइल फॉर रिक्वेस्ट फॉर एग्जामिनेशन, व्हाट इज आल्सो कॉल्ड एज आरएफई. यू हैव टाइमलाइन ऑफ 4 इयर्स विद इन विच यू कैन फाइल आरएफई. लेकिन आप डे वन पे भी, जिस दिन पेटेंट फाइल कर रहे हो तभी भी आप रिक्वेस्ट फॉर एग्जामिनेशन कर सकते हो. रिक्वेस्ट फॉर एग्जामिनेशन के बाद ही एग्जामिनेशन रिपोर्ट जनरेट होगा. पेटेंट ऑफिस वुड जनरेट examination report. Remember that examination report is generated only after publication. That means aapne filing jis din kiya us din bhi aap request for examination kar sakte ho, the form you can fill, but examination would happen only once the application is in public domain, once it is in public domain or published. Now this is the the examination report, what we also call as the FER, first examination report for the invention. Now this is that letter from for one of the applications, so for St. Xavier's College Mumbai, so we got an examination report from them. Now what does an FER contain? Basically, examination report contains certain aspects like novelty, inventive step, and applicability, patentability under section 3. Now what happens is herein is the technical examination. Now I got a very interesting question here, and that is coming from Nilashri Vankhede. Does the patent prosecution process time vary for each applicant? What if the process time is long and somebody else comes with the same novel work and publishes in a reputed journal than filing, waiting for a patent? Interesting question. Why I'm saying this is, this happens very, very frequently actually. आपने जिस दिन patent file किया है उसी दिन आपके पास legal rights है. You are the first one to file. If someone publishes, that's absolutely fine na. They don't have the legal right for that. Journal mein publish karke wo party ko kya milega? You would have the legal right for the invention. And does the patent prosecution process time vary for each applicant? It's not applicant dependent, Nilashri. It is dependent on invention, the complexity, the prior arts, the technology, the time required basically. Because aap ye cheez samajhiye Nilashri ki कभी कभी वॉट अ पीएचडी साइंटिस्ट वर्क्स फॉर 7 इयर्स द एग्जामिनर हैज टू अंडरस्टैंड इन अ डे, राइट? और द कंट्रोलर हैज टू क्रिएट अ एफईआर मे बी इन अ मंथ्स टाइम फॉर दैट. सो दैट विद द टाइमिंग वुड वैरी नॉट बेस्ड ऑन एप्लीकेंट. सो देर इज नो डिस्क्रिमिनेशन एज फार एज एप्लीकेंट इज कंसर्न. इट वुड गो थ्रू द नॉर्मल प्रोसेस. But then again, so if it's a technology which is very difficult to understand, it may take a longer time. And depending on the what kind of prior arts actually, or what is that invention, how big is your invention or the patent draft actually, based on that as well, it would depend on actually. But definitely it's not based on the applicant's. That's not the criteria patent office uses. Now, what does an FER contain? As I said, आपका invention novel है कि नहीं, आपका invention non-obvious है कि नहीं. Now I'll tell you the difference between novelty and inventive step. Novelty, as I said, absolute novelty would include the newness of the invention, whether your invention is new or not. That is the most important thing actually for the invention. That's the first criteria. Now what we do in research, unfortunately, I'll tell you in cases of nutraceutical products or something, there is a good product available in the market. It contains 4 or 5 ingredients. What we do, we try to replace one with other. So ABCDE ki jagah ABCDE plus kar dete hain, and we come up with a new product. That new product is novel, definitely, but then that replaced component, is it predictable to achieve? E ka jo function hai, wo exactly same function E plus kar raha hai. In that case, it is predictable. So inventive step is all about predictability of the art. Okay, prior art mein jo inventions diye hue uska predictability kitna hai. Based on that, your inventive step is evaluated. Third criteria, industrial applicability, which means whether your invention is used by the industry, made by the industry, or made for the industry. Based on that, your invention. So all these points would be mentioned in your first examination report, whether it's new, whether it's has an inventive step, whether it has industrial applicability, or does it fall under section 3 A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, whatever. So in case of computer programs, it may be 3 KRs. Now, yahan tak, everything is all fine. No need of patent agent, I would say. You can file on your own. The moment you have a first examination report, replying to that, again, it's a legal document. So you have to reply it in a way that. So basically, I'll tell you, patent prosecution is a two-way communication between an applicant or an agent with patent office. It's a two-way communication. E-filing, electronic filing ke through hota hai actually. But then important thing herein is that you need to, as Dharmendra ji already pointed out, you need to abide by the deadlines. You need to abide by the deadlines. FER reply ka deadline 6 months ka hota hai, which can be extended by 3 months as well. So 6 months plus 3 months, 9 months tak aap ye kar sakte. Okay? That's how you would reply to the examination report. Now this is the stage, So I'll also tell you where is the cost coming for an applicant basically, or as an institution or as a individual basically. The costing is at the time of filing of a patent application, because of drafting and filing cost, request for examination, official patent office cost, FER reply, professional charges by patent agent. Yahan pe ho sakta hai without FER bhi patent grant ho jaye. That is also possible, which is very rare actually, but then that is also possible if the examiner feels or the controller feels, then they can grant the patent without FER as well. But as I said, it's very rare. But then FER reply ke baad, if the controller is satisfied, in that case, the patent can get granted at this stage only. And aapka costing khatam ho gaya, aapko sirf renewal cost dena hai. But in case the examiner, the controller is not satisfied, they would call for a hearing notice. Now abhi tak jo ho raha tha, that was a written communication between applicant and the controller, or the patent office and the applicant or agent. This is an opportunity wherein you would have an opportunity to speak directly with the controller through hearing. There would be a hearing notice. This is the last stage for patent prosecution basically. In hearing, it is the only opportunity wherein you can convince the controller that, okay, this is how my invention is different from the prior art, and this is the reason you should get it granted basically. And of course, it's like kind of, I would say, debate kind of stuff, wherein the applicant or an agent can convince the controller and say that, okay, these are the differences, but then the controller would say that no, but although these are the differences, this is why we feel it is obvious basically. After hearing, as I said, that's the last stage, application gets granted or rejected. And if it gets granted, you get this wonderful certificate from patent office. It's a wonderful certificate by patent office, jis pe government of India ka emblem bhi hai, your patent number, application number, date of filing, patentee, the title, all this with the controller signature and the date of grant as well. You would get this lovely certificate, and this is where your journey of a patent application ends. Patent gets granted. Now, when I say the journey of a patent application ends, it also means that you have to renew the invention or the patent. You have to pay some fees, renewal fees basically, for the patent till 20 years actually, as in as long as you want it to be protected, basically legally protected actually. Okay, I have this question, and I think Amrita, does synthesis process of a material be patented if it is a new method? Amrita ji, generally the process for preparing a material are patented. Okay, if it is new, but then Amrita, also you need to remember it is not predictable as well. It has to be unpredictable, so it should have certain inventive step as well, then only. Of course, you need to satisfy all those gold, what we call golden criteria of patentability: novelty, non-obviousness, also called as inventive step, and the third one is industrial application or use of that particular invention, and the fourth criteria, which is country specific, which is the exclusions under section 3 or section 4 actually, right? So that's what I have for you. I would be more than happy if there are any further questions, you can put it in the chat box. Thank you so much everyone for joining us. Thank you so much Dr. Coach sir, Dr. Sushil, Dharmendra ji, for guiding the students and the faculties as such for taking this. And I think the real outcome of this kind of IPR awareness program would be something wherein we actually see some kind of filings coming from the institution, as Dr. Khot already mentioned, the institution is quite supportive. I would like to conclude on a note that it's just not about the filing of the patent or getting it granted. Try to commercialize it as well. I had this opportunity to be at the launch of entrepreneurship cell of FCRIT with a lot of students actually, managing that event. It was really good to see that young students, that though that kind of energy that you have, and you also have a very wonderful setup, SIBA, as Coach sir mentioned in the inaugural remarks actually. So SIBA is a wonderful setup wherein for Dharmendra ji and Bhavna, it's an incubation center at and it's supported by Department of Science and Technology. One of the best incubation centers that we have in Mumbai is within the premises of FCRIT Institute. I was based at SIBA for a month or so. I have interacted with a lot of faculties at FCRIT that point of time. So just think of on those lines as well, students as well as faculties, just not patenting, but commercializing, making it into a real product. Remember that whatever you do in your lab, whatever products you do or prepare or whatever you invent, doesn't have a value for me unless and until it is for the benefit of the society. And that's what the first or primary reason of research or innovation is. Thank you. Thank you so much once again. And over to you, Bhavna.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for such a elaborative session and the motivational words at the end of your talk, that you want commercialization of the patented technology, not just getting a patent granted. And thank you so much for the motivating our young entrepreneurs for that. Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to invite Dr. Sushil Thale to give a vote of thanks for this session. Dr. Sushil Thale.
Thank you, madam. So good afternoon to everyone. So we have reached to the end of this webinar, which is on a very important topic related to the IPR. Today, I, Dr. Sushil Thale, Dean R&D and the President of FCRIT Innovation Council, take this opportunity to put my gratitude into the words. I could directly relate the whole talk by Dharmendra Pal as well as Shukriti sir, because it was very simple. At the same time, it was very much in the depth. I was able to relate fully. When I filed my first patent in 2014 and gone through the whole process of the what is being explained today, I was able to understand what happened at what stage and how it actually finally got granted. And I'm really happy that I witnessed that complete process and I was able to see that complete iteration today in the particular presentation. And I'm sure that this will be surely helpful to all our faculties as well as students, which are in the dilemma of what to do, how to do, where to go, whom to approach. All these questions are there in front of you. While doing the research, this is a very, very important critical stage to work upon. So I should thank honorable speakers for the today's event, that is Mr. Alam, Joint Director and Head of SOCHM, IPR Council, Mr. Dharmendra Pal, Examiner of Patent and Designs from the Patent Office, and Mr. Vijay Kumar Shivpade, basically who directed me to help particularly in this direction to organize this event. Actually, we are very much thankful to all of you for guiding all the participants and on this very important topic of IPR. The session was really, really informative, and to say that this was the one of the best IPR webinar I attended today. Okay, so thank you, sir, for your inputs on the IPR. I am also thankful to Indian Patent Office, Government of India, ASSOCHAM, and ASSOCHAM taking this initiative and helping us to understand this critical but very important step in research and development to go from idea to an IPR. It was really, really great insights for all of us for this day. I must not forget to thank the whole organizing team that includes Mr. Shukuje and Ms. Bhavna Mittal from ASSOCHAM and their colleagues who are working hard for the last few days to make this seminar successful. I'd also like to thank all the participants for their active participation. Really, they were present throughout the session and really great question answer session we had about it. I also like to extend my sincere thanks to our principal, Dr. Asim Cook, whose guidance and constant support was there throughout this particular avenue. Also, wish to thank our management for all their kind support for organizing this event. Thank you, everyone, once again for making this particular webinar a great success and really insightful for everyone. Being an academic institution, it will be really, really grateful for us. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sushil Thale. On behalf of ASSOCHAM, I would like to thank Indian Patent Office who has supported us for organizing such webinar, and I must thank FCRIT too that they have supported us in organizing this event with the your students and faculty members, and I would like to thank all. Both of our resource persons, Mr. Dharmendra Pal from Indian Patent Office and Mr. Vijay Kumar Shivpuje, who have given such an elaborative session for all the attendees today, participants. And I must say participants from FCRIT are very, very motivated, and they are very interactive audience. So much questions they have put in, and we were having good discussion kind of webinar today. And thank you so much for joining in. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone. Yeah. माता पक्षी वहां जाने का मतलब अच्छी है रात में कोई वैक्सीन नहीं वो तो कुछ नहीं होता
तो मास्क भी नहीं पहनते
और मास्क भी नहीं पहनते
सर हो गया बट एंड नहीं करना आ रहा मुझे
नहीं नहीं आप कर लो वेट वो कैंसिल टीम कैंसिल 30 जनवरी को वापस आ रहे हैं कैंसिल कैंसिल ऐसा क्या मतलब कोई इस ड्यूरेशन में कोई नहीं पेंगे सिर्फ
तो मतलब